In tonight's episode, I'll talk a little bit about the streamers and some of their productions. I have some horror flicks for you. And will Netflix ever learn how to properly end a movie? Plus, tonight features the return of Rex. Real. We've had Rex on hiatus. He's actually been exclusively online, and he returns back to the show tonight. Start off by telling you I'm one of the few people, I think, that really enjoyed the first two Resident Evil movies. Now, again, I got to say up front, I have never played the game, and I understand where the gamers have all kinds of problems with the movies, and I have no knowledge of that because I've never played the game. But the first two movies I thought were pretty good B-grade science fiction action flicks, and you had Mila Jovovich back in the day in tight leather. I can't go wrong with something like this, right? So I enjoyed those first two movies, and I have to admit that they began to deteriorate after that. And by the time they did the last one, it was kind of silly. I think the producers knew that too, and that's why they did a reboot. However, they decided to take Resident Evil and turn it into a TV series on one of these great streamers. And, you know, I got to tell you something, that even from somebody who liked the first two movies, the amount of the woke agenda that they put in this TV series completely ruined it. Normally, I give three episodes of a series before I decide not to watch it. After the first episode, I thought, oh, this can't be. I gave it a second one for general purposes. Wow, it became worse instead of getting any better. This thing is just absolutely horrible. Here's a look at the TV series Resident Evil.
We have a problem. The drug contains the T-virus. The T-virus can make monsters.
Billions will die.
Everyone keep your mouth shut.
Greetings, salutations, and other sundry affair. I am your cinematic professor and purveyor of truth in movies. We have an awful lot to cover on tonight's episode. First, let me remind you that we are sponsored by the House of Feruza Barbershop and Cigar Lounge. They're located on the corner of South Park Road and Drake Road, and I have a pretty big announcement about their second annual pig roast coming up. I'll give you that a little bit later on in the show. Hey, in the teaser, I mentioned that we are going to have the return of Rex Real tonight. And, you know, for his return to TV, we actually brought Rex down to Sam at the House of Feruza. And, you know, I didn't want a complete makeover, all right, because, you know, that's too drastic. But I told Sam, look, can you take Rex and just kind of give him a fresh look? You know, not a complete makeover, but, you know, something a little bit new. So Sam obliged. And now, for those of you who haven't, maybe you're watching this in the morning, and you haven't had your second cup of coffee yet, so it hasn't kicked in quite yet. Here's a reminder of Rex Reel. The last time you saw him on TV, he looked like this. And we took him down to Sam's. We sat him in the chair, and Sam did his magic. And now the new and improved Rex looks like this. And you will see that new Rex a little later on. And I think Sam did a fantastic job. You know, I mean, he makes me look good. Why wouldn't he make Rex look good? Okay. So, which do you like? Do you like the new look for Rex, or do you like the old look for Rex? Well, we're going to run a little ballot up on the social network, especially Facebook. I'll put up both pictures, and you get to pick which one you like better, the old Rex or the new Rex. That'll be kind of interesting. We'll let that run for a couple of weeks and see how it goes. Don't forget to vote online right on the Facebook page. I'll probably run that URL up here for you. This way you can get onto the Facebook page and you can cast your vote. Old Rex, new Rex. Snazzy looking, wouldn't you say? I think that's all fair game. Speaking of fair game, that's the title for the first movie we're going to tackle down tonight. And I got to tell you, this is really a silly story about some good old boys who are pranking this woman. And the pranking goes terribly, terribly wrong. And the movie is kind of, it comes from Australia. So it's kind of a cross between Crocodile Dundee and Home Alone. Odd combination. Cassandra Delaney. And she is our protagonist in this. Her main goal in life is to protect animals. And so she runs a sanctuary there for animals. And she goes bonkers when she discovers that there are poachers on her land. And those poachers are played by Peter Ford, David Sanford, and Gary Who? And Don Baker. They all decide that they're going to tie her kangaroo down, sport, so it causes a bit of conflict. The film is shot by Andrew Lesney. You know, Andrew has an Oscar to his name, and it's directed by Mario Andriciccio, and he has an Emmy to his name, so some big heavies behind the camera. I just wish they'd have had a lot more substance to deal with here. It really turns out to be just a run-of-the-mill type of action flick. The female warrior agenda is in great show here, but the sequences are really, really forced and basically unbelievable. Delaney does have a very athletic body. You think she would have been able to handle some of these action scenes a little bit better. And the trunk hood scene in this movie is, although it's quirky, it is sure to raise any man's blood pressure. But I got to tell you, other than that, this one is best left in the land down under.
They were renegades. She became the target of their savage hunt. She was fair game. Pay the price. Fair game.
You know, the PR for The Dead Girl in Apartment 3 makes this thing look really kind of spooky. But, you know, I gotta tell you, when I started watching this movie, I was getting a strong sense of deja vu, not just with one scene, but with multiple scenes. I was beginning to wonder if maybe this was a reshot reissue. Now, let me explain what that is. A lot of times they'll shoot a movie, they'll release it, somebody notices it and decides to put a little bit more money behind it. So they reshoot some scenes, boost it up with a little bit of an augmented budget, and then re-release it under a different title. And I thought that might be the case with this movie. I searched several databases that I check regularly. I could not confirm my assumptions. So while this had a very familiar mien to it, apparently it stands on its own. The story is totally implausible. Shortly after moving to New York City, a young woman discovers that her roommate is dead. Now, strange things begin to happen after the police investigate and remove the body. Our heroine decides that she is going to solve the mystery of her roomie's death, and she ends up doing better police work than the cops do. After all, the cops cleaned the room before the investigation was finished. They missed the strange scratch marks on the door, and they totally overlooked the witchcraft box that was hidden in her closet. Laura Dooling is our protagonist in this movie. She thrusts her bust line out through this movie very, very dominantly. But I got to tell you guys, it's only just the tease in this one. Michael Shantz plays the detective with an eye for Dooling. And Adrian King, veteran horror star, is his veteran partner attempting to quell his rather rabid libido. The special effects on the demons are kind of lame on this. You can tell it was done on a budget and that budget was very, very small. They utilize dark lighting, very dark lighting, and even an extended blackout scene where he's just sitting there listening to it. It's a fair to middling horror tale with a few jump scenes in it, but no real conclusion to it. Now, it's streaming this month, but it will be available for home video in November. Here is a look at the dead girl in apartment 3.
What?
Your friend. What was her name?
I think you can check the mail.
You don't know how to spell your friend's last name?
They just moved here.
Do you really think that girl had something to do with her roommate's death?
Listen. One thing I've learned from this job is that it doesn't matter what you think. It's what you know, and what you know is always changing. No signs of trauma, and no indications of homicide. She appeared healthy.
Lisa! A couple more horror films. A couple of decent thrillers I got coming up for you. Plus, the return of Rex Reel, all when Outtakes with Rex Reel continues right after this. We're very proud and happy to have as a sponsor for our show the House of Feruza Barbershop and Cigar Lounge. I've told you about all the great things they can do in making you take a new look on. Look what they've done for Rex Reel just in tonight's show alone. But I've got to tell you that they have some great events set up at the Cigar Lounge. And their annual pig roast is coming up. Let me get the date on this for you. It's August the 27th, and it will start at noon. This is really a good time. Food, beverage, and of course, excellent, excellent cigars. There are games to be played. I think they're having a cornhole contest. So there's a whole lot of things going on for that whole day. $20 in advance, $30 at the door. My advice, get down there, see Sam way before the event, buy yourself a couple of tickets, and hey, we hope to see you there. It was a great event last year. In fact, they oversold it. There were people that had to be turned away. Don't let that happen to you this year. It's the Pig Roast at the House of Feruza Cigar Lounge. They're located at the corner of Drake Road and South Park Road. That'll be August 27th at noon. We will see you there. Welcome back to the show. I have a couple of more horror. You know, there's a theory that horror movies come out in abundance when things in society generally are in disarray. If that holds true, we must really be in disarray because there is a veritable plethora of horror films coming out, and I want to get as many of them as I can to you. You know, you can always do that on the websites too, because I always review movies on the websites that don't necessarily make it into the script for the TV show. So you want to check those out as well. Don't forget we're on YouTube, Rumble, MeWe, Gab, and Parler. So any one of those, you'll be able to find Outtakes with Rex Reel. Next movie I want to talk to you about is called Of the Devil. Wow. This is the brainchild of Kelton Jones. And when I say brainchild, he was the writer, the director, the editor, the director of photography, and he also plays Detective Murphy in the thing. So this is really his baby. It's all about a Mexican demon, and it serves a cult through a really nice, magnificent, large blue butterfly. Now, when a young boy touches this butterfly, the demon is transferred into him via a brain tumor. Well, no doctors can help this lad, and the parents are beside themselves. So his very frustrated parents decide to take him to the surgeon. The surgeon turns out actually to be the high priest of this demonic cult. So the surgeon ends up killing the boy, but the boy returns as the embodiment of the demon. This is kind of like a Pet Cemetery thing comes in here, okay? Starring in this are Danny Pavlenchio, Jonathan Stoddard, Lucas Sequeira, and Vernon Wells shows up in this in a little cameo. It's not much. And he shows up long enough to die, I guess. Put it that way. Folks, the endings of this movie really leaves an awful lot to be desired. I got to tell you, the movie is one of those rare horror films when you can actually say the devil truly has his day. But in so doing, Jones is a little bit sacrilegious in his final depictions.
Even with the best treatments, glioblastoma is extremely aggressive, and we're looking at 14 and a half months at best. In Alex's case, due to the size and location of the tumor, he wouldn't survive surgery.
I know a surgeon. He knows the power behind life and death.
Thanks. We're okay.
I don't know what's going on with him.
Do you think this is some form of possession?
Okay, finally, we're going to put the horror films to bed and pick up on the thrillers. The first one is called Dawn. Folks, I got to tell you, though, we're going from bad to worse in this review. This film is just god-awful. No nice way to say this. It comes from the folks at Uncorked, and they usually put out some nice stuff. So somebody must have been really hungover when they agreed to distribute this film. Now, it's all about a lunatic Uber driver who secretly creates snuff films on the dark web. Normally, you might say that's a pretty decent premise for a thriller, but wow, it goes so. The driver is played by Jackie Moore, and she gives so much sanctimonious dialogue justifying her life choices as to induce vomiting on the part of the viewer. The couple she picks up is played by Jared Cohn and Sarah French. They have to be the dumbest people on the planet as they are given, through the course of the script, a plethora of opportunities to escape, and they never take advantage of them. Also in cameo roles are Eric Roberts and Michael Perry. You know, those big names. They must be in the movie for a total of 2, maybe 2.5 minutes. So this was nothing more than an easy payday for them. This mess was directed by Nicholas Ryan, and it was written by Ryan along with Dawson Doop, or he may say Dupe, I'm not sure which. Folks, I can't find any redeeming value to this excrement on celluloid. You need to avoid this at all costs.
I love you so much.
I love you too.
Okay. What do you want from us?
Tonight, I want you to prove something to me.
Rule number one, you don't always touch canvas.
You lost the game. Say goodbye.
Rule number two, always have fun.
People love my work.
I live to consume and destroy.
Some more thrillers. Can Netflix find a way to end a movie? And the return of Rex Reel, when Outtakes with Rex Reel continues right after this. Welcome back. I feel like I always want to welcome back my friends to the show that never ends. I'd probably get a letter from ELP saying, don't do that anyway. So, that's for you and the audience who are a little bit older and can understand that kind of. You know, there are a lot of big stars that are going over into the studios that go direct to streaming. Don't blame them. There's a pretty big payday there. Naturally, Netflix is probably the biggest studio, and it's pulling in a lot of names. For this movie, they pulled in Ryan Gosling and Chris Evans, two pretty big names in this, and I'm talking about the movie of The Gray Man. So they're able to pull in all of these big stars, and let me tell you that The Gray Man has some great action in it. It takes, I'm going to say, between 10 and 12 minutes to set up the premise of this movie, and then it takes off, and it does not let up until 2 hours later. This thing is really a celluloid roller coaster ride. But the same problem happens in this movie as what happens with almost every other Netflix movie. They do not know how to edit, and they do not know how to end the movie. This movie goes on for probably 20 to 25 minutes longer than it should, and the ending is nonsensical. The ending should have happened beforehand, not when it does. It just, they don't know how to end this thing. I think they're purposely trying to make the movies long for some reason, and as a result, they put in all this junk at the end that really isn't necessary. This could have been a really, you know, dynamite film, and that ending just totally blows it. The action in the movie is great. The ending is weak. Here's a look at The Gray Man.
They have something they really want.
What's your gut?
It's going to be my funeral you're going to next.
You want to make an omelet? You got to kill some people.
You must be Lloyd.
What gave it away?
The trash stash. It leans Lloyd.
Easy.
About to put a hit so big on your boy's head that even his most loyal allies won't hesitate to drop a dime. Every grade A wet team from here to Reykjavik will be vying for the prestige of killing the infamous Sierra Six. I can kill anybody. Maybe not anybody.
Okay, I've been promising the entire show, so now it is time to peel back the veils of time, back to the early Cretaceous period, for the nation's first and only prehistoric film critic, Rex Reel.
Two foreign films this show. Skip fair game. It is silly. With bad dialogue and unrealistic action. Greed. Watch Chestnut Man, a good thriller and well paced over 6 episodes. Greed. Several horror films. Dawn is dreadful. Avoid in all ways. Fail. Dead Girl in Apartment 3 and Of the Devil Are Weak with poor scripts, special effects, and acting. Watch only if you are bored. Greed.
Ah, it's good to have Rex back. Hey, we got to wrap this bad boy up. Before we do that, I want to tell you that the show received a very nice thank you note from the folks at Paramount Senior Living up on Baptist Road. They had contacted the show. They were having their annual fundraising event and wanted to know if we could help. Well, any time the show has an opportunity to help the community, we do that. We put together, they were having a Chinese auction, so we put together a nice little basket filled with movie paraphernalia for them. Apparently it went over exceptionally well, and they sent us a nice little thank you note. So we're glad that they contacted us, and we're certainly glad that we were able to help the community out in this small way. Don't forget to get online, especially Facebook, and vote for whether the new look or the old look for Rex Reel. Voting is online right now. And don't forget about Sam's Pig Roast on August 20th. I think you're going to have a good time at that, and I hope to see you down there. You know, the websites have been growing. Small, but growing. I think we picked up 5 new subscribers on YouTube since the last show, and 3 on Rumble. Those are very small, you know, especially when you compare them with some of the bigger boys on those platforms. But, you know, a plus is better than a minus, and I'm kind of happy with that, so that's a good thing. The Outtakes with Rex Reel podcast is coming soon. I've been telling you, and it's getting close. You want to look for it real, real soon. And before we duck out of here, a couple of things I want to let you know about. I want to say a special congratulations to the Spooky Spectre. The Spooky Spectre and I worked together for a good number of years. They recently had a vote for Best TV Horror Host, and Spooky ended up in the top 10. I think he ended up 6th or 7th. Let's go with 6th. It's higher. And that's fantastic. So we want to say congratulations to the Spooky Spectre. He is also a friend of our very own Captain Calico Drake. The three of us worked together for a good number of years back in the mid and late 90s, and we had some really good times. So glad to see something like that happening. And we want to say hi to Josh, new personnel here at BPTV, our home station, and he worked behind the camera tonight. So, you know, if anything went askew, don't write me. Right, Josh. So I want to welcome him along as well. You know, that's it. We are completely out of time. So now that you have learned what you have learned, here endeth your lesson.